Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Star Wars and Philosophy Strike Back. This is the Way. Edited by Jason T. Eberl and Kevin S. Decker. Series edited by William Irwin. Narrated by Al Kessel. Limit of liability, disclaimer of warranty. While the publisher and author have used their best efforts in preparing this book, they make no representations or warranties with respect to the accuracy or completeness of the contents of this book, and specifically disclaim any implied warranties of merchantability or fitness for a particular purpose. No warranty may be created or extended by sales representatives or written sales materials. The advice and strategies contained herein may not be suitable for your situation. You should consult with a professional where appropriate. Further, readers should be aware that websites listed in this work may have changed or disappeared between when this work was written and when it is read. Neither the publisher nor author shall be liable for any loss of profit or any other commercial damages, including, but not limited to, special, incidental, consequential, or other damages. Introduction. Boba Fett Riding a Rancor. In 2005, when we published Star Wars and Philosophy, More Powerful Than You Can Possibly Imagine, the release of the Star Wars prequel trilogy was about to be concluded with Episode 3, Revenge of the Sith. Fan response, as well as critics' reviews, were generally tepid. The best we could have hoped for was that George Lucas might redeem himself by completing the last three films in a planned 9-film arc that would come to be known as the Skywalker Saga. At that time, we couldn't have predicted that Disney would purchase the franchise from Lucasfilm in 2012 for $4.05 billion in cash and stock. The next year, Disney announced an ambitious slate of standalone Star Wars films, as well as hinting at a sequel trilogy. It also announced that the Star Wars Expanded Universe would be rebranded Legends and no longer be canon. Only Lucas's episodic films and television series, The Clone Wars, would be considered canon in addition to new works. For fans of Mara Jade, the Yuuzhan Vong, and Borsk Felya, it was tantamount to literary genocide. Would Disney Lucasfilm recreate the post-Return of the Jedi galaxy in an equally entertaining and philosophically interesting way? Although Star Wars had become an integral part of American culture, we also couldn't have predicted the extent to which it would become a touchpoint for controversy in the American culture wars of the early 21st century. Plenty of fans didn't care for The Force Awakens, The Last Jedi, or The Rise of Skywalker for aesthetic, canonical, or personal reasons. Yet sequel trilogy directors Rian Johnson and J.J. Abrams made precisely the right move in writing characters and casting actors, and so declaring that women and people who hail from marginalized groups are part of grand narratives too. Using codes such as "keep politics out of entertainment" and projecting their own toxicity onto Lucasfilm and Disney, the reprehensibly anti-feminist, anti-diversity casting Phantom Menace movement politicized the films in a way surprising and distressing to OG fans like ourselves. Yet, the very fact that such a distasteful response occurred shows that, like other great sci-fi fantasy narratives, Star Wars can hold a mirror up to our own culture and offer a poignant critique. Finally, we wouldn't have guessed in 2005 that Star Wars could have been revivified through its television presence. After all, prior to Gennady Tartakovsky's 2003 Clone Wars miniseries, Star Wars on TV existed as little more than formulaic children's programming, from the intentionally lost canon of the Star Wars Holiday Special in 1978 to the 1980s Droids and Ewoks animated series and live-action Ewok specials. The 7 seasons of The Clone Wars that premiered on Cartoon Network in 2008, however, offered a serious and multi-layered set of story arcs for Obi-Wan Kenobi, Anakin Skywalker, Padme Amidala, and their opponents. Further miniseries airing on the Disney Plus streaming network, created and guided by Dave Filoni and Jon Favreau, have shown that it's still possible to get Star Wars right. That magical mix of humor, action, empathy, characterization, exciting quests, and fan service. On the premiere of The Mandalorian, one of us told his classes that it was the best Star Wars film to be released since Return of the Jedi. And yes, we finally got to see what must be the fantasy of so many franchise enthusiasts, Boba Fett riding a rancor. This volume is a little different from our previous ones. We want to thank Marissa Kors, formerly an editor at Wiley Blackwell, for her insistence that this book follow a chronological structure, beginning with topics from Episode 1 like What Does the Ethics of the Force Share with Natural Law Theories of Morality? And moving forward in time through the original trilogy to a critical assessment of the value of friendship between Rey, Finn, and Poe in the sequel films. Because of this chronological structure, we've been able to include chapters that focus on philosophical topics in the animated series Rebels and The Bad Batch, standalone films Rogue One and Solo, and The Mandalorian. We've also been able to encourage our authors to reflect on how their topic fits into the history of the greater Star Wars universe. Sometimes they delve into Legends material to make their claims, a move licensed by the argument of Roy T. Cook and Nathan Kellen in The Ultimate Star Wars and Philosophy, You Must Unlearn What You Have Learned. The conventions and practices that were shaped and encouraged by Lucasfilm themselves with regard to the canon-non-canon divide, in particular, the dynamic, negotiable, and participatory nature of this distinction, throw some doubt onto whether or not Lucasfilm truly has the authority to unilaterally dictate which Star Wars stories, or versions of stories, fans should take to be genuine parts of the central story. Star Wars is, after all, about rebellion, they add. If you're interested in the ways in which newer Star Wars narratives demonstrate the importance of ethnicity on alien worlds, or how love and sex with a droid like L337 would work, it works. You'll find answers within. If you've ever wondered if Count Dooku's Separatist Freedom Movement has anything to say about the struggle for social justice in the USA in the 21st century, we've got you covered. The metaphysics of time and why we ought to maintain hope in dark times are both addressed in the coming pages. Our contributors even explore defenses of director Rian Johnson's take on a defeatist Luke Skywalker and pose the question, should you eat Baby Yoda? As Star Wars Galaxy Far, Far Away continues to expand, so do the philosophical questions that inspired some of the brightest minds in our own galaxy. We invite you to join our clan of 37. Sometimes the dark side makes it hard to see what other philosophical lessons Star Wars has yet to teach us, and yet, here we are. This is the way. Part 1. Episodes 1 through 3. 1. Another solution will present itself. The Phantom Menace, Taoism, and Doing Without Trying. Russell P. Johnson. The Phantom Menace, TPM, is one of the most polarizing films in the Star Wars franchise. When it was first released in 1999, some fans claimed that it ruined their childhood. But for many fans since then, it's been their childhood. Ironically, Taoism, the philosophical religion that rejects controversy and division, has a lot to do with this controversial and divisive movie. If we watch this film with some classical Chinese philosophy in mind, the different narratives, themes, and characters start to make more sense. In short, the philosophy in TPM is to Taoism what Taco Bell is to Mexican food. TPM may not be the most authentic example of Taoist philosophy, but it's got some of the same flavors. This is the way. Classical Taoist thinking, found in texts like the Tao Te Ching and the Zhuangzi, says that everything we experience is always changing, often into its apparent opposite. Day is always turning into night, and night is always turning into day. Cold weather becomes warm in the springtime, and warm weather turns cold in the fall. At least this is how it works in China. On Hoth, the weather just tends to stay cold. There's a rhythm in the natural world. The sky produces water, which nourishes trees, which are then burned in fires, which sends smoke back into the sky, and so on forever. When living things die, they become food for other living things, and so on forever. This constant flow from one state of being to another is the nature of all things. Nothing is permanent except for change. This is true not just of the natural world, but also of the political one. Totalitarian, rigid empires tend to become overbearing, which causes rebellions and anarchy. Anarchy creates a power vacuum, which leads to new rulers, like the First Order, who become increasingly rigid in their use of power, and so on forever. In our own lives, too, we see this fluid, changing process. If you are calm and permissive, you let things happen that'll ultimately make you angry, yet expressing your anger ultimately calms you down. Everything flows into its apparent opposite. Nothing is static and fixed for all time. Apparent opposites also depend on one another. Warm means nothing without cold. There's no such thing as being cold unless warmth also exists. If it were not for darkness, there could be no light. We would not be able to label anyone tall unless we are comparing them with other people who are short. We could not recognize Chewbacca as strong unless we contrast him with someone who's weak, like C-3PO. The distinctions we use to separate things into good and bad, hard and soft, calm and angry, can make us forget that these apparent opposites depend on one another and are always turning into one another. According to Taoism, there's a fundamental unity to all of reality that we forget when we try to separate what's valuable from what's worthless. We have the tendency to make sense of the world by privileging one side of a dichotomy over the other. Happy is better than sad, young is better than old, moral is better than immoral, smart is better than dumb, sharp is better than dull, fast is better than slow. After making these distinctions, we tend to find value only in one side and not the other. I'm wealthy and not poor. I worked very hard to be wealthy and not poor. I'm proud of myself for being wealthy and not poor. By doing so, we forget that any one side in a dichotomy depends upon its apparent opposite, flows into its apparent opposite, and is part of a more fundamental unity. Wealth depends upon poverty and is always coming from and returning to poverty. To think otherwise is to be deluded. A classic example is dirt and flowers. Flowers grow out of the dirt, and then they die and decompose and become dirt. In The Last Jedi, Rey gets a glimpse of this when she's meditating on Ahch-To. Life, death and decay that feeds new life. For Taoists, the human problem is basically that we want there to be flowers without dirt. We want to hold on to one thing at the expense of its apparent opposite, but that's impossible. Symbols like the well-known Taiji diagram, the yin-yang symbol that's emulated in the Jedi Temple on Ahch-To, can help us remember the fundamental unity of all things and free us from our tendency to think in terms of stark opposites. Everything contains within itself the seed of its opposite, so apparent opposition is always misleading. In addition to those symbols, Taoist writings also feature many stories where someone who may seem useless, another pathetic life form, turns out to be successful, or something that seems to be worthless turns out to be invaluable. One classic example is a tree so gnarly and curved that it cannot be turned into planks for building. The tree grows to a great height and provides shade for the emperor, and it's able to do that precisely because of its worthlessness. As the Tao Te Ching says, the soft, the weak prevail over the hard, the strong. Just as we see the tiny primitive Ewoks help topple the technologically sophisticated and powerful empire. A symbiont circle. In TPM, there's similar emphasis on the inevitability of change and the tendency for opposites to depend on each other. In one scene, young Anakin Skywalker has just been freed and is saying goodbye to his mother, Shmi. He complains, "I don't want things to change." And Shmi responds, "But you cannot stop the change any more than you can stop the suns from setting." This sounds a lot like the Zhuangzi. Just as we cannot keep the sun, or suns, from setting, so all of our efforts to hold on to happiness, wealth, or reputation are ultimately going to fail. But since the sun has to set in order for there to be a new morning the next day, we too can let ourselves change without really suffering any loss. TPM also features many examples of those who are apparently useless and worthless triumphing over those who have better training, technology, or skills. The local boy Anakin implausibly defeats Sebulba, who always wins. The young and naive Queen of Naboo drives out the powerful Trade Federation. The little droid R2-D2 restores power to the shield generator. The primitive Gungan militia holds their own against the vastly superior droid army. TPM emphasizes that we should not rely too much on our judgments of who is capable and who is not. The seemingly insignificant slave boy is in the process of becoming a Jedi Knight, and the seemingly indestructible droid control ship is in the process of becoming space dust. Symbiosis is also a theme that runs through TPM. Two civilizations on the same planet, the Naboo and the Gungans, depend upon one another. As Obi-Wan Kenobi explains to Boss Nass, "You and the Naboo form a symbiont circle. What happens to one of you will affect the other. Flowers depend on dirt, which depends on flowers. Light depends on dark, which depends on light. Cold depends on warm, which depends on cold." The opposition between the Naboo and the Gungans only conceals their fundamental unity. Qui-Gon Jinn echoes this idea when teaching Anakin about midichlorians. He says that living beings and midichlorians are symbionts, life forms living together for mutual advantage. Mutual dependence, not opposition, is the natural order of the world. Doing without trying. If we agree with the Taoist picture of the natural order, what should we do about it? Do we just do nothing? Well, yes and no. Instead of striving to be rich, virtuous, or famous, the better way to live is to recognize the fluid nature of reality and act accordingly. This is the idea of non-action, or wu wei in Chinese. If, when we act, we are striving to grasp one side of a dichotomy but not the other, to have flowers without dirt, we'll constantly fail and be frustrated. The more we try to make things turn out the way we want them to, the more we'll mess them up, just as Anakin's turn to the dark side in order to save Padme tragically results in her death. Striving to achieve one side of a dichotomy ironically drives one further into its opposite. The more a nation clings to security and pursues it at all costs, the more insecure and ultimately susceptible to fear and war it becomes. The more a parent tries to control a child, the more rebellious the child will become. The harder you concentrate and try to accomplish something, the more you'll psych yourself out and become unable to do it. Taoists read history this way too. One dynasty overreaches and tries to control too much or govern too strictly, and then that dynasty collapses, making room for the next dynasty. The Old Republic, out of fear and war, becomes the Empire, which later collapses, and the New Republic is born, which then falls to the First Order until the last is defeated, not by a navy, but just people. If our actions align with the natural flow of reality, however, we'll be able to succeed without really having to do anything. The person who moves fastest down the river is not who swims the hardest, but who positions themselves so they are carried along by the current. Taoist sages, Zen Ren, give up anxiously trying to make things turn out how they want them to be. Instead, they let their actions be governed by the same fundamental unity that governs the constant flow of change in the natural world, the social world, and the emotional world. The Tao Te Ching says, "Act on things and you will ruin them. Grasp for things and you'll lose them. Therefore, the sage acts with non-action and has no ruin. Lets go of grasping and has no loss." The way to gain power and long life and peace is paradoxically by not trying to achieve them. Acting organically instead of intentionally, you can live in the moment rather than using all of your energy to try fruitlessly to bring about a specific future. So if you had to give a one-sentence summary of Taoism, you could do a lot worse than, "Do or do not. There is no try." Concentrate on the moment. TPM is filled with characters who are not living in the moment but are focused on the future. More specifically, it's filled with people making predictions that turn out to be wrong. The Jedi assume the trade negotiations will go smoothly. They are right, but not in the way they expect. The Trade Federation leaders assume the Jedi will be no match for their destroyer droids. They are wrong. Jar Jar predicts that the bosses will do terrible things to him. That does not happen. Amidala thinks the Senate will side with her. They will not. Newt Gunray thinks Amidala will be easy to control. Wrong. Palpatine says that the Jedi will be no match for Darth Maul. Half true. Watto says he knows Sebulba's going to win. He does not. Captain Panaka thinks this is a battle they cannot win. They do. I could go on, but you get the idea. Every story involves characters not knowing what's going to happen. This creates dramatic tension and is art being true to life. But more than most movies, TPM's characters keep thinking they know what's going to happen, keep trying to make things happen, and keep misjudging the future. One theme in TPM is that predictions and assumptions are, in general, best avoided, which connects with the Taoist emphasis on existing in the moment rather than trying to discern the future and make it turn out the way you want it to. To be empty and open to what happens is wiser than being fixated on your expectations, assumptions, and plans. Taoism emphasizes that success comes most often through a complex set of factors too multifarious to comprehend or even take into consideration. It's not that you should not want good things to happen, but rather that the act of trying to bring about your understanding of a good future is as likely to bring misery as to bring happiness. Good outcomes are often unplanned and spontaneous, and we should be open to what happens rather than focusing our energy on trying to make something happen. Taoist stories depict apparent chance bringing about good fortune, people finding something exactly when they were not looking for it, or folks saving the day exactly when they stopped trying to play the hero. These stories remind readers and listeners that human beings aren't great at making events turn out how they want them to. But this is no reason to despair. One Taoist parable is about a drunk man who falls from a horse and is not injured. He does not tense his body up to brace himself for the impact. He just literally rolls with it, and his relaxed muscles and joints do not get injured, a trick pro wrestlers use. The implied lesson is that if you stay flexible and roll with things as they happen, you'll be better able to live in the world than if you always think about what you are doing and whether it's working or not. The story, by the way, is not endorsing drunken horse riding. Or at least, I'm not endorsing drunken horse riding. You should always have a designated driver, or at the very least, a sober horse. Qui-Gon exemplifies this tendency to stay in the moment and trust in the flow of reality. In some ways, Qui-Gon's actions and non-actions resemble those of a Taoist sage. In fact, the name Qui-Gon is likely derived from Qigong, a set of Chinese practices for aligning the energies of one's mind and body with the natural order. Qui-Gon tells Anakin, "Remember, concentrate on the moment. Feel, do not think. Use your instincts." As the prequel trilogy goes on, we see to what degree Anakin fails to follow this advice. Everyone else in TPM is stressed and worried about things, but not Qui-Gon. So, you are being eaten by a fish? Do nothing. There's always a bigger fish. Jar Jar asks, "Where Wisa going?" Qui-Gon responds, "Do not worry. The Force will guide us." Their bongo starts to lose power, and Jar Jar exclaims, "Wisa dying here!" Another wrong prediction. Qui-Gon calmly replies, "Just relax. We're not in trouble yet." "Cannot get where you are going? No problem. Land on Tatooine." "Sandstorm coming? Cool. Stay with the nearest 9-year-old. "Betting everything you have on a child in a death race? That is fine." After Darth Maul arrives on the scene, Anakin asks, "What are we going to do about it?" Qui-Gon takes a deep breath and says, "We should be patient." When there seems to be no way off Tatooine, Qui-Gon says, "I'm sure another solution will present itself." This summarizes his whole character. After a Sith assassin comes for the Queen, Qui-Gon laughs and counsels patience. Afterward, we see Palpatine, Amidala, and Valorum talking about how distressed and anxious they are. Clear contrast to Qui-Gon. Unlike almost everyone else in TPM, Qui-Gon is not quick to make judgments. When asked whether the Queen's idea will work, he does not answer. He often says, "I'm not sure." Even when he thinks Anakin is the chosen one, when asked about it, he says, "I do not presume." This starts to change toward the end of the film, but for the most part, Qui-Gon remains in the moment, doing non-doing, being mindful, and aligning his will with the living force. The Zhuangzi says, "When you let go of the world, you are free of entanglements. Free of entanglements, you are balanced and untilting. Balanced and untilting, you are reborn along with every presence that confronts you." This sounds like Qui-Gon Jinn. He is not chasing a goal so much as allowing every encounter to show him something, acting based on what each changing moment offers to him. Now this is pod racing. TPM's final victory is not the result of conscious intention. Anakin does not have a plan to fly to the Trade Federation's control ship. He just starts pressing buttons, and things keep working out for him. The Queen has a plan, but it's failing. Meanwhile, Anakin's actions are the opposite of a plan. He's on autopilot, and then when he's not, he's like, "I'll try spinning. That's a good trick." This is not exactly a strategy. After Anakin shoots the torpedoes that destroy the ship, all he can say is, "Oops." Intercut are similar scenes of Jar Jar succeeding through his own seeming incompetence. He keeps accidentally dropping bombs and destroying enemy droids by chance. It's played for laughs, but there are similarities with Taoist stories of eccentrics achieving success without trying for it. Victory comes not through careful planning or heroic effort, but rather by Anakin being in the moment, acting without acting, just like Qui-Gon told him to do. He's not doing anything, and yet everything is done. 2. Bioethics Wars: Fear and Fallacy in Revenge of the Sith, Thomas D. Harder. Imagine that the next time you are out in public, you come across two people in a fist fight. Stunned and afraid, you watch but do not intervene. Soon, one of the fighters gains the upper hand. The other attempts a counterattack but fails as the first brutally beats the other. The winner then calmly walks away while the fallen fighter cries for help. Moments later, emergency medical services arrive and begin tending to the beaten fighter, who's barely breathing and bleeding profusely with broken limbs. The fallen fighter is medically stabilized, given pain medication, and transferred to the nearest hospital. Later, you see a news story about the fight and learn that the fallen fighter was operated on for many hours and survived. The beaten combatant needed both legs and an arm amputated and had to be fitted with prosthetics to regain the ability to move independently. The fighter's lungs were permanently damaged, and so he was given a tracheostomy, a procedure for attaching a mobile respirator to breathe normally. The fighter also experienced severe throat damage, making it impossible to safely swallow food, meaning he needs a feeding tube to eat. People are typically grateful for medical technologies used in the treatment of illness or injury. Without knowing any of the context of the case just presented, most listeners would be astonished and horrified by the winner's actions, which appear callous or even malicious. And they'd be thankful for the medical providers and the medical technology that saved the victim's life and allowed him to function independently. Yet, this is not how movie audiences are expected to feel about the on-screen fight between Obi-Wan Kenobi and Anakin Skywalker in Revenge of the Sith. Instead of viewing Obi-Wan, the fight's winner with horror as he walks away from a mortally wounded Skywalker, who'd become Darth Vader, audiences are led to feel both grateful that Obi-Wan vanquished Skywalker and disappointed that Emperor Palpatine found him in time to allow medical technologies to prosthetically restore Skywalker's body. Something's amiss. How can it be possible that on 21st century Earth, technology is typically praised for helping people overcome illness or injury, while in Star Wars, technology and technological innovation are generally treated negatively as something to be feared rather than praised? In this chapter, we'll explore how Lucas has led Star Wars audiences astray into accepting false beliefs and fallacies about the value of technology, particularly in a medical context. Fear is the path to the dark side. Ethics is the branch of philosophy that addresses questions about how people should live and interact with one another. In its most basic form, ethics is the study of what it means to be good and to act rightly. Bioethics is the study and practice of ethics in a medical context, particularly how we should research, develop, and use medical practices and technologies to help others. An example of a bioethics dilemma: if two rebel soldiers are wounded in battle but there's only one back-to-tank available, who should get it? One person might answer this question by saying, the soldier who was wounded first should get the tank, while another person might argue that the tank should go to the soldier with the worst wounds, or perhaps the soldier with the best chance of surviving. Yet another person might argue that the only fair thing to do is randomly pick who the tank should go to. We must look to facts as the essential starting point to answer questions like this. An important fact we know about the Star Wars films is that they are George Lucas's interpretive retelling of ancient mythologies that, at their heart, are about the idea that all persons have good and evil traits, and that all people can freely choose how to act on them. We also know that Lucas intended that human relationships with technology would be a prominent theme. During a 1999 interview with journalist Bill Moyers, Lucas states, "One theme is our relationship to machines, which are fearful, but also benign, and they are an extension of the human, not mean in themselves, just as a lightsaber is an extension of its Jedi or Sith wielder." Although Lucas does not tell us what exactly he means by technology being an extension of persons, it's reasonable to assume that what he means is that technology has no inherent value, but instead has value only in terms of how it's utilized by persons. In addition to facts, context is important when addressing bioethical questions. Different facts and pieces of information presented from different perspectives can change the assessment or outcome of a bioethical deliberation. Imagine an unmodified sheathed lightsaber lying on its side. If looked at from either end, it appears circular. If looked at from the top down, it generally appears rectangular. But a lightsaber is neither a circle nor a rectangle, so neither perspective is a fully accurate depiction of the cylindrical shape of a lightsaber. Likewise, narrative stories only show the narrator's perspective, but not necessarily the full picture. In Return of the Jedi, ROTJ, C-3PO captivates the Ewoks with his rendition of the basic plot of A New Hope and The Empire Strikes Back. The movie-watching audience knows and can verify the truth of C-3PO's summary. The Ewoks, however, know nothing about the battle between the Empire and the Rebellion prior to C-3PO's tale. The story of the Ewoks here is completely one-sided. C-3PO could be lying to them, and the Ewoks would not know any better. Storytellers have great power over their audiences and can lead them in any direction they want, truth be damned. Consider the misleading storytelling around the human relationship with technology in Anakin's final transformation into Darth Vader. Lucas leads the audience to fear this transformation, conveying a perspective about the value of technology that stands contrary to its actual value in a medical context on 21st century Earth. What I told you was true, from a certain point of view. Points of view matter. Star Wars fans know that truth all too well. If Lucas's goal was to explore technology as something fearful but also benign, he succeeded but also failed. From his point of view, Anakin's final transformation into Darth Vader is nothing short of horrific. After Anakin is seduced and corrupted by the dark side of the Force, he's confronted by Obi-Wan on Mustafar. Obi-Wan mortally wounds Anakin by dismembering him with his lightsaber. After telling Anakin how much he loved him and that they were brothers, Obi-Wan leaves Anakin, screaming in pain, to die on the shore of the lava river. Emperor Palpatine finds and rescues Anakin, who's barely alive. We then see Anakin lying on a metallic table in a dark room being attended to by medical droids. His legs have been replaced with metal prosthetics, his left arm still missing. He remains conscious throughout the ordeal, thrashing his body and screaming in pain as the droids work on him, removing bits of charred flesh. That he remains conscious is an important nuance, as it depicts the medical process as something painful and harmful. The Emperor wants Anakin to suffer as part of his final transformation. As the droids complete their work, and Vader's now infamous mask is lowered in place, his eyes open wide for a brief second, then narrow with sad resignation to his fate that he is, as Obi-Wan later describes him, more machine now than man, twisted and evil. Fear of technological transformation is well communicated in this scene. Technology as something benign is not. despite Lucas's claim that he wished to show technology as fearful but also benign, that is not the message audiences are left with. The Anakin to Vader physical transformation scene is perhaps the starkest example in the entire Star Wars canon of the fearful side of technology. But maybe we are not being fair to Lucas. As he noted in the Moyers interview, he wanted to show Vader as a repulsive, composite man who's lost a lot of his humanity, so there's not much, actually, human left in him. The Anakin to Vader transformation was Lucas's way of visually and viscerally showing Vader's transformation from good to evil. So it might be that Vader is the exception rather than the rule. However, throughout the Star Wars mythos, technology is rarely shown in a positive light. Rather, technology is something to be questioned, abused, as with the treatment of most droids, discarded, or feared. The Death Star and its decimation of lush Alderaan. The cyborg body of General Grievous, which raises a question we'll return to at the end of the chapter about using technology to enhance persons, and the Imperial Navy are all examples of Lucas showing technology as fearful, but not benign. Conversely, what's natural and technologically unaugmented is treated as good, pure, or innocent. Its loss is grieved. We see this when Obi-Wan misleads Luke about what really happened to Anakin. Rather than be forthright with Luke that Anakin is Vader, he instead tells him that Vader betrayed and killed Anakin. To Obi-Wan, the fact that Vader is more machine now than man is equivalent to Anakin being dead. The Ewoks, another example, are portrayed as simple, innocent creatures who literally live in tree houses. The Jedi wear earth-toned, free-flowing robes, and their entire mythos is about being in balance with the natural order, as we see both Obi-Wan and Yoda adapt to their respective desert and swamp climates on Tatooine and Dagobah, while the Empire embraces technology to dominate and rule. Notice, too, how, after Luke loses his hand fighting Vader and it's replaced with a robotic hand, he hides it beneath a black glove. From my point of view, the Jedi are evil. There are two primary concerns with how Lucas portrays technology in Star Wars, and specifically regarding the Anakin to Vader transformation. First, his perspective is built on the naturalistic fallacy. This fallacy is the mistaken belief that because something is natural, it is necessarily also good. If this belief were true, it would mean that certain states of human existence that occur naturally but are otherwise undesirable are actually good, such as poor eyesight, poor hearing, headaches, or bacterial infections. The philosopher David Hume, 1711 through 1776, helps us understand why the naturalistic fallacy is an error in reasoning. Hume argues that it's logically problematic to jump from an is statement to an ought statement. Is statements are empirical. They tell us verifiable facts about the world. For example, that Obi-Wan left Anakin to die after their battle on Mustafar. Ought statements are value statements about how people should think or act given certain factual statements. Obi-Wan should, or should not, have left Anakin to die after their battle on Mustafar. Because factual statements are value neutral, giving or attaching value to a factual statement requires showing how the concepts, the fact itself, and the value someone gives to the fact are tied together. The naturalistic fallacy wrongly makes an is-ought connection about what's natural. As an example, the fact that Force-sensitive beings can serve the will of the dark side of the Force does not mean that they should. But in Star Wars, with few exceptions, what's natural is assumed to be good or valuable without clearly explaining why. Via the naturalistic fallacy, Lucas conveys the false belief that most technology is unnatural and so is bad, harmful, or associated with the dark side. There are multiple examples, ranging from the use of cloning technology to create an army and to allow Palpatine to survive his pseudo-death in ROTJ, to the use of prosthetics to save Anakin's life and finalize his transformation into Darth Vader, to the creation of the Death Star and the Imperial Navy. Rarely does Lucas attempt to display the possibilities of technology as helping the worst-off creatures in the galaxy. Imagine how different Star Wars would be if the films tried to show the Rebels using portions of the Death Star plans to create technology capable of growing food crops on Tatooine. A pathway to many abilities some consider to be unnatural. It should be clear at this point that Lucas's portrayal of technology in Star Wars is one-sided and does not map onto 21st century reality, a context in which it has helped humanity overcome many natural obstacles that threaten the quality and length of many lives. In addition to mass production of clothing, food, and shelter, medical technologies, such as ventilators, feeding tubes, prosthetics, and cardioversion machines to help restore heartbeat, have helped people survive and recover from many potentially fatal events. It may be tempting to say Lucas's portrayal of technology is simply wrong. However, this would be too rash a conclusion. Lucas is not wrong that technology can be fearful, but its value depends in part on how it's intended to be used. Even the use of some medical technologies that can extend life raise questions about whether they should be used in all cases. Many bioethical conflicts center around whether a seriously ill or injured person would want certain medical interventions used to extend their life, given potential trade-offs. Some people are like Darth Vader and need a ventilator to support their breathing for the duration of their lives, but not everyone wants to be connected to a machine in perpetuity. Lucas's portrayal of technology in Star Wars is biased against its true value in societies. However, to assume that because the use of technology is not always negative, it's therefore positive and should be used, for example, to enhance persons, like General Grievous, is also a fallacy, known as the technological fallacy. This fallacy, like the naturalistic fallacy, wrongly assumes an is-ought connection between technology and its value. People commit this fallacy when they assume technology is good or must be utilized. While it's possible, a la Martin Heidegger, 1889 through 1976, to argue that technology has its own metaphysical reality and so has inherent value. For Heidegger, a negative one, that's independent of how it's used. It's also common to view technology as inherently value neutral, only having value in relation to its application. Whether technology should be used to save Anakin's life after his mortal injuries is a different question than whether technology should be used to enhance one's natural state of being, as in the case of General Grievous. Without medical technology, both Anakin and Grievous would have died from their respective combat wounds. But whereas the prosthetics of Darth Vader do not improve his abilities, and in fact hinder his physical movements, Grievous's cybergenic body gives him physical and mental capabilities beyond the natural state of his original, non-enhanced body. Morally, some will make the argument that people should take opportunities to enhance themselves when they can. After all, we are typically encouraged to enhance ourselves through education, exercise, and healthy diets. However, there are serious concerns and risks with arguing that technology should be used to enhance persons. One worry is that technology used to enhance persons may lead to divisions of moral status. The enhanced may view themselves, or be viewed by others, as having superior value over the unenhanced. Just as Clone Force 99, later known as the Bad Batch, was engineered to be superior to other clone troopers. Even if enhanced persons aren't considered or treated as superior to the unenhanced, there are still concerns that enhancement could result in conflicts of interest between the two groups, resulting in rights of the unenhanced being restricted. The Sith are the embodiment of this concern. They believe that the enhancement of mastering the dark side of the Force gives them a greater standing among all other beings and entitles them to rule the galaxy. Bringing balance to the Force? Lucas's portrayal of technology in Star Wars is flawed. Despite claiming that he wanted to show technology as both fearful but also benign, he fallaciously presents most technology in a negative light. Yet, Lucas's treatment of technology is not without merit. Embracing technology as inherently valuable is also fallacious. Instead, the value of technology should always be viewed in the context of how it's used. That Anakin was saved and his body restored after medical intervention is something that typically would be applauded, but how this event is portrayed in Revenge of the Sith generates the opposite reaction. Audiences are led to lament Anakin's final transformation into Darth Vader and not condemn Obi-Wan callously leaving Anakin to die on Mustafar. Perhaps, though, showing Anakin's physical transformation and his need to rely on technology to survive is exactly the point. The Skywalker family, especially Anakin, is prophesied to bring balance to the Force. That Anakin and Luke are both maimed and need prosthetics shows that technology itself is value neutral. Its moral value depends on specific context. While Star Wars is set a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away, context remains important for ethical decisions in our world, where rapidly advancing technology can blur the line between human and machine. 3. A pathway to many abilities some consider to be unnatural. The natural law ethics of Star Wars. Matthew Shea, Joel Archer, and Daniel Banning. According to George Lucas, Star Wars is a morality play, a mythological tale of good and evil that's meant to teach timeless lessons about the moral life. The ethical galaxy of Star Wars is marked by a conflict between the light side and the dark side of the Force, with the saga's heroes and villains identified by which side they serve. Although the moral messages of Star Wars are in some ways simple and commonsensical, the moral system behind the Force is complex and mysterious, lending itself to different interpretations. This chapter notes how the moral framework of natural law ethics provides a philosophical foundation for the morality of the Force and helps illuminate Star Wars' moral themes. Natural law ethics. A first step into a larger world. Natural law ethics has ancient roots, encompassing philosophers such as Plato, approximately 427 to 347 BCE, Aristotle, approximately 384 to 322 BCE, Cicero, approximately 106 to 43 BCE, Augustine, 354 to 430 CE, and Thomas Aquinas, 1225 to 1274. The version we'll explore is inspired mainly by Aristotle and Aquinas, the two most influential thinkers in the natural law tradition. According to them, morality is based on human nature and human flourishing, and can be known by natural reason, our built-in intellectual capacity for practical reasoning. In short, we don't need a divine lawgiver or a Jedi council to tell us right from wrong. The purpose of morality is to promote and protect what's good for us, the fulfillment of our nature as human beings. For Aristotle and Aquinas, to be human is to be a rational animal with the capacities of intellect, knowing, and will, choosing. According to this view of human nature, creatures who aren't biologically human but have these capacities will count as human beings in the sense relevant to natural law ethics because they act as moral agents. So maybe Han Solo wasn't simply being sarcastic when he referred to Jabba the Hutt as a wonderful human being. Characters like Jabba, Chewbacca, and Ahsoka Tano are rational animals and moral agents, even though they belong to non-human species. Unpacked a bit more, human beings are essentially intellectual, volitional, social, emotional, and physical organisms. Human flourishing consists in the development and exercise of these natural capacities and the attainment of their corresponding ends. For example, we have intellectual capacities that are aimed at truth, so knowledge is a human good. We have the capacity to make free choices, which is why autonomous agency, especially morally significant choice like that between the light side and the dark side, is a human good. We have social powers, and thus personal relationships are good for us, whether they take the form of familial love like that between Anakin and his mother, romantic love like Anakin's and Padme's, or friendship like that of Anakin and Obi-Wan. We have emotional capacities that enable us to appreciate beauty, which is why aesthetic experiences, like watching a binary sunset, are good for us. We have physical powers aimed at survival and proper physiological functioning, so life and health are human goods. The natural law, Aquinas says, is the light of natural reason, whereby we discern what is good and what is evil. It's natural because it's based on human nature and knowable by natural reason. It's a law because the natural law is equivalent to the moral law, which prescribes how we ought to live. The natural law consists of basic moral truths that are objectively and universally true, independent of personal opinion, cultural convention, time, and place. So what's right or wrong is the same for bounty hunters in the Outer Rim and senators on Coruscant. Every human being whose rational powers are functioning properly know basic human goods and basic moral principles, beginning with the first supreme principle of morality. Good is to be done and pursued, and evil is to be avoided. When Luke Skywalker asks Yoda, "How am I to know the good side from the bad?" Yoda endorses the idea of natural moral knowledge by replying, "You will know." Using reason, we can know that things like knowledge, freedom, friendship, life, and health are good for us, while ignorance, enslavement, loneliness, death, and disease are bad for us. We can also know more specific moral principles that govern how we ought to act, such as, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Do not murder. Do not steal. Help friends in need. Keep your promises, and do or do not, there is no try. On top of human goods and moral principles, Aristotle and Aquinas stress the importance of moral virtues, habits of acting, thinking, feeling, and desiring in morally appropriate ways. Virtues such as practical wisdom, courage, justice, honesty, and benevolence make us good human beings and are necessary for our flourishing. For instance, an excellent human being, say Padme Amidala, is wise and brave. In order to flourish, she must be able to discern which ends are really worth pursuing. For example, defending the sovereignty of Naboo against the Trade Federation invaders, and what the best means are for achieving them. Leading an armed resistance rather than waiting for the Senate to discuss this invasion in a committee. She must also have the fortitude to overcome obstacles to flourishing, challenging the Republic's corrupt bureaucracy and risking her life in battle against the droid army. Justice, honesty, and benevolence perfect our nature as social beings and are needed for the sake of social harmony and positive relationships with family, friends, and fellow citizens. By contrast, moral vices are obstacles to human fulfillment. An unwise person will be unlikely to pursue what's truly good or to pursue it in an effective way, as when Anakin turns to the dark side in a vain attempt to save Padme. A coward will be too afraid to pursue or protect what's good when doing so requires risk or sacrifice, like Lando when he initially betrays Han and his friends to the Empire. And someone who's unjust, dishonest, and malevolent will be unlikely to have friends and belong to a peaceful and supportive community. Jabba the Hutt, Boba Fett points out, ruled Tatooine by fear, not respect. On the natural law approach, what's natural in the morally relevant sense is what's good for us given our nature. Moral goodness is natural and beneficial because respecting moral principles and cultivating virtues fulfills human nature and contributes to human flourishing by perfecting our human capacities and enabling us to attain human goods. Moral evil and having vicious dispositions toward doing evil is unnatural and harmful because it's contrary to our nature and thwarts our flourishing. In a literal sense, the moral life makes us more fully human, whereas an immoral life is dehumanizing. The morality of the Force, twisted by the dark side, saved by the light. One of the overarching moral messages of Star Wars is that the light side fosters human flourishing and the dark side undermines it. Being on the light side is natural and moral because it promotes goods such as life, health, knowledge, friendship, beauty, peace, and inner harmony. Being on the dark side is unnatural and immoral because it undermines those goods and brings evils like death, disease, ignorance, loneliness, ugliness, discord, and internal division. This message is communicated through the plot as we see the consequences of characters' good and evil choices. It's also expressed visually. A recurring visual motif is that the light side is humanizing, whereas the dark side is dehumanizing. All the major Sith villains experience death, disfigurement, dismemberment, or mechanization as a result of their evil choices. Darth Maul, Count Dooku, Anakin Skywalker, and Sheev Palpatine are abandoned, betrayed, or killed by their fellow Sith. Maul's eyes exhibit the yellow color characteristic of the dark side, and Anakin's eyes become yellow after he turns to the dark side and commits mass murder in Revenge of the Sith, R.O.T.S. Palpatine is physically deformed by the use of his own Sith lightning in the same film. Anakin and Dooku both lose hands. Maul is cut in half in the Phantom Menace and ends up with mechanical legs in the Clone Wars. Most dramatically of all, shortly after Anakin becomes Darth Vader, he's dismembered, physically scarred, critically injured, permanently dependent on technology, and completely hidden within an armored suit, to the point where he is, as Obi-Wan Kenobi puts it, more machine now than man. These are all examples of characters losing their humanity and undermining their own flourishing by their immoral choices. The light side, by comparison, is humanizing and beneficial. Virtuous characters use the Force to attain goods in extraordinary ways, and the Force enhances their human capacities so they can perform their natural functions even better. For example, in the Mortis story arc from the Clone Wars, Altar of Mortis, the mysterious character known as the Daughter uses the Force to transfer her life energy to the deceased Ahsoka, bringing her back to life. In the episode of The Mandalorian titled The Reckoning, Grogu uses Force healing to cure Greef Karga's poisonous wound and prevent his death. In ROTS, it's revealed that Qui-Gon Jinn's spirit was able to survive his physical death, allowing him to experience eternal life. He later teaches other Jedi to do the same. The Jedi abilities of Force meditation and foresight, seeing the future, give them special kinds of knowledge. The Force augments their physical powers, giving them enhanced reflexes, speed, strength, dexterity, and jumping ability. In The Empire Strikes Back, TESB, Luke and Leia are able to communicate telepathically via the Force. The Force also gives Jedi the ability to see things non-visually by reaching out with their feelings. Kanan Jarrus from Rebels and Chirrut Imwe from Rogue One, for instance, have this special kind of perception even when physically blind. Now, there are apparent counterexamples of Jedi and other virtuous characters who are dismembered or dehumanized, which may seem to count against the natural law interpretation of Star Wars visual imagery. For instance, Anakin hasn't yet turned to the dark side in Attack of the Clones, AOTC, but he's dismembered by Dooku. Luke's hand is severed by Darth Vader in TESB. Mace Windu is dismembered by Anakin when he attempts to assassinate Palpatine in ROTS. Saw Gerrera, one of the founders of the Rebel Alliance, is shown in Rogue One to have suffered extensive physical damage that's left him partly mechanized and dependent on artificial technology, reminiscent of Vader. These aren't real counterexamples, though, because in each case, the character's dehumanization is the result of a morally bad choice. Anakin attacks Dooku in a spirit of pride, recklessness, hate, and aggression. Luke exhibits arrogance, impatience, impetuousness, and foolishness when he rushes to confront Vader against the better judgment of Yoda and Obi-Wan. Windu is attacked by Anakin because he tries to execute vigilante justice on Palpatine, taking the law into his own hands and usurping the rightful authority of the judicial system, which, as Anakin warns him, is not the Jedi way. Guerrera's injuries come after he commits acts of violent terrorism against the Empire that harm innocent people in the spirit of the end justifies the means. All of these actions are immoral according to natural law theory and further illustrate the dehumanizing and destructive effects of evil. Natural law theory can also explain one of the central moral themes in Star Wars, redemption. After Anakin turns to the dark side and becomes Vader, some of his closest friends, including Obi-Wan and Yoda, believe that he's gone and beyond saving. Padme and Luke, however, maintain that there's still good in him and hold out hope that Anakin can come back to the light. At the end of Return of the Jedi, Anakin is redeemed by the love of his son. As Luke is about to be killed by the Emperor, the good in Anakin is finally awakened and he sacrifices his life to save his son, thereby returning to the light side and fulfilling his destiny as the Chosen One, who brings balance to the Force. The lesson here is that no person, not even Darth Vader, is beyond saving. Everyone always has some goodness in him or her that allows for the possibility of moral and spiritual redemption. Aquinas maintains that the natural law can't be completely abolished from the heart of man. He argues that vice and evil can cloud the mind and distort the will so that we fail to know specific moral principles and to make correct moral judgments in particular cases. But the most general principles of the natural law, in the abstract, can nowise be blotted out from men's hearts. Aquinas is referring to the knowledge of fundamental human goods, the supreme moral principle to do good and avoid evil, and some basic moral norms like don't murder, tell the truth, and treat others fairly. All people, no matter how wicked their character or how many horrible things they've done, still have some natural knowledge of good and evil and some natural desire for the good. Some deep recess of the human soul is always aware of and aimed at the good. Aquinas helps us see why Padme and Luke are right to think they're still good in Anakin, despite how twisted and evil he'd become, and why Anakin is redeemable in the end. Jedi and Sith ethics, similar in almost every way? Natural law theory also explains the moral perspectives of the Jedi and the Sith. Their rival moral codes display conflicting views of human nature and human flourishing, keeping in mind that human means rational animal rather than Homo sapiens. During his conversation with Anakin at the opera in ROTS, Palpatine says that the dark side of the Force is a pathway to many abilities some consider to be unnatural, and that good is a point of view. The implication is that the Jedi and Sith disagree about what's natural to human beings, and consequently, what's good and evil. To start, they have fundamentally different conceptions of human nature. The Jedi see human persons as spiritual beings who are capable of mystical union with the Force and with other living entities. As Yoda tells Luke, "Luminous beings are we, not this crude matter." The Sith see us as nothing but material beings, which is evident in their attempt to create and extend life through midichlorian manipulation, cloning, and technological apparatus, as opposed to the spiritual immortality experienced by some Jedi. For the Jedi, human beings are relational by nature, existing as members of the interconnected and interdependent community of all living things, united through the Force. For the Sith, human beings are atomistic individuals, existing independently and self-sufficiently. Even the closest relationship in the life of a Sith, between master and apprentice, is marked by ruthless individualism, for a central tenet of the rule of two is that the apprentice tries to kill the master. The Jedi see human beings as naturally altruistic and motivated to help others. As Anakin puts it to Palpatine, the Jedi are selfless, they only care about others. Relatedly, a defining human trait is the will to serve. The Sith see human beings as egoistic and motivated by self-interest. For them, the defining human trait is the will to power. This is why Palpatine tells Anakin that the Sith and the Jedi are similar in almost every way, including their quest for greater power. A central characteristic of the Jedi is that they respect the natural order and act in accordance with nature. The Sith revolt against nature and violate the natural order. According to George Lucas, to be a Jedi is to accept the natural course of things. Anakin's inability to follow this basic guideline is at the core of his turn to the dark side. The contrast is most apparent in the ways the Jedi and Sith approach the beginning and end of life.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.